Multicultural and community work requires that we tear down walls and build bridges. But sometimes it's hard to get involved because we're afraid that we'll do the wrong thing. We doubt ourselves, but really, are we asking the right questions? Tear down walls and build bridges. Well, that's been a personal mantra of mine for many years. And that's to do what it takes to create a fair and compassionate world, do the work with the people who are marginalized, not for them. Not for them, but for myself and for us all. And I come by these sentiments quite honestly, perhaps because of a peculiar circumstance of my childhood that led me to work for justice and advocate for the underdog. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself and how it led to my path of ministry and my passion for social justice. You see, my family was the only black family in Hamilton, Illinois, which is on the Mississippi River, 1,800 people. And when I was growing up in the 50s and 60s, it was pre-civil rights era. So I know what it means to be treated unfairly, to be maligned for being different, and to be viewed as a stereotype, lazy, dirty, stupid, a thief. And then even the more positive stereotypes are no less disconcerting or problematic. Well, I can tell you now, I cannot sing like Mahalia Jackson. I cannot preach like Jesse Jackson, and I cannot dance like Beyonce. So, I did get an excellent education in Hamilton and a very firm religious grounding also. But at age 12, I had an epiphany during our Presbyterian catechism. And I asked some questions that I didn't know I wasn't supposed to ask. I asked, well, what about the kids born before Jesus? Or what about the ones that don't know about Jesus? And the very simple answer was, yes, they are going to hell. It's in the Bible. I didn't know it then, because I didn't have words for it. But that was the day that I became a Universalist. So even as I stand here in solidarity with those of you who are already out in the community doing the work, and while I'm here inviting those of you who are not active to come in and get your hands dirty and do the work of justice, even as I'm asking you this to do this, I have to admit that it's difficult work and it can be fraught with pain and frustration. I'm going to tell you two stories about some of the work that I've done and some of the results of those things. First, I'm a member of the Interfaith Alliance in Peoria, and I've also attended the last two Parliaments of the World Religions. In Barcelona in 2004, I really focused on learning about Islam. There are just hundreds and hundreds of courses that you can take at these parliaments. So I focused on Islam there. And then in 2009, when I went to Sydney, Australia, I focused on Judaism in Barcelona, Islam in Sydney, Australia. Well, do you remember the Fort Hood shootings? That was November 5th, 2009. And I felt compelled to ask the Interfaith Alliance to do something because I feared that there would be some kind of backlash against our Islamic brothers and sisters. And so with the Parliament of World Religions just being 1 month away, that's the reason I decided to focus on Islam. And one of the things that happens at the Parliament, there aren't big decisions made, but there is always a call that we go out, go home, be part of the grassroots, and make a change. And so I was really inspired to lead a committee that included some Islamic people who have now become friends, and we stay in touch. We had several programs that were for the community. Now, the successful part of it was that we figured out that we could be friends and that there were things that we had in common and that we wanted to keep working, and maybe someday we would do a special project together. But along with that success of bringing people together, there were some real problems and some real disappointments. First of all, we didn't have any participation in any of our programs from the Jewish community or the fundamentalist Christian groups. And some member of the Jewish community regarded our interest in learning more about Islam as in some way dismissing Judaism. One of the worst things was that the Islamic customs regarding women almost derailed our entire process, because people on the committee started thinking, well, why should I be doing this work if they don't respect me? And then in regard to our Muslim committee members, this is difficult for me because I wanted to know everything I could about Islam, and they didn't really want to know anything about being a Unitarian Universalist. So, and one of the things that is always difficult for me, it's hard for me to work with people who think I'm going to hell. And so, but I overcame that, and we did do some projects together that were successful, and we did some things with youth. The problem is, it is so hard to do that work, and I've been busy with school, and no one else has taken it up. So for more than a year now, there hasn't been any other work done. I don't think we have energy for the long haul. And unfortunately, we've just barely begun to tear down those walls, and we are now kind of at a stopping point. Now, this next story is really dear to my heart because it represents a level of failure that is difficult for me to come to terms with. Last year, I was an intern in a chaplaincy program called Clinical Pastoral Education, and I'll be referring to that as CPE. It was at a Central Midwest Medical Center for 10 weeks. Almost every seminary student in the country has to go through CPE, which is a very structured program, and they encourage lots of bonding with the other chaplain trainees. And this may give you a clue as to how strident the training is, because CPE is often referred to as chaplaincy boot camp. And it's tough in a lot of ways. And in this particular program, there was an emphasis on forcing us to break down emotionally. Well, the other four people in my cohort were Andrew, Daniel, David, and Joseph. Yeah, right. So I nicknamed our little band the Saint Namesakes Plus One. So, and we were of different denominations, and of course, as a Unitarian Universalist, I was on the far right, and I don't know how to signal that. That's my right, but not yours. Anyway, on the far right, and then in descending order of liberalism, we had a Presbyterian graduate from McCormick Theological School, a Catholic in his fourth year of formation for priesthood, an evangelical Lutheran who had been an Eagle Scout, and the first time he ever cursed in his entire life was in the fifth week of CPE. And then there was Joe. Now, Joe had been a Southern Baptist, but he thought they were too liberal. So he began attending a non-denominational church. Now, one of the remarkable things about Joe was that he had single-handedly raised $40,000, got a group of people together, and gone to Uganda to build a school. So that his dedication to his beliefs was exemplary for all of us. So over the 10 weeks that we had together, we had assignments that required us to talk about our religious beliefs, and especially we were supposed to talk about any misgivings that we had about our religion or its policies. And these proved to be pretty emotional conversations. Joe believed that every word in the Bible is true and that the contradictions would make sense if we could understand their meaning. Once when I referred to fundamentalism, Joe said, "I'm no fundamentalist. I have real problems with those people." So as the five of us were forging ourselves into a loving community because we did love each other, we ran into some difficulty, primarily because two of us in the cohort belong to groups that are maligned in the Bible. One of the interns is gay, and then I'm a black female. So I would get into these quandaries, and I would get upset with Joe and some of the things he said. And finally, I started asking him, do you respect me? And if you believe every word in the Bible is true, how can you respect me? And about halfway through the course, our supervisor told me that having Joe in the class was really a godsend, because I wanted to do interfaith work and community work, and that this would be a good opportunity for me. Well, in fact, that is what is at the heart of my disappointment, because that is the kind of work I want to do. The last week of CPE, I posed a question to the group. Could we build something together? And three of the saint names said, yes, yes, yes. But Joe was silent, and he never responded to the question. So I'm going to share with you what I wrote in my final evaluation of the course. And we have to read these evaluations in front of the other people so they hear this. And so this is what they all heard, including Joe. I didn't begin CPE with an agenda or expectation of intercultural bonding, but it soon became clear that there would be challenges around religious beliefs. Because I want to work with people of different faiths, I was hopeful that Joe and I could come to some kind of meeting of the minds. I am deeply disappointed and saddened that we will not be building any bridges, schools, or orphanages, even figuratively. Our relationship feels fragile, and I don't know that it would survive further challenges, even though each cares for the other. Failure to build a more robust, trusting relationship after working together for 9 weeks makes me despair of being able to make much progress toward peace and understanding with other people who hold fundamentalist views, whether those ideals are Christian, Jewish, Muslim, atheist. If we can't do it when we have supervision and a structured program to help us, what hope is there? Well, needless to say, walls were still up, and there was no bridge to bring Joe and me closer to each other, and I left CPE with a profound sense of failure and sadness. Okay, you've heard two stories from my life, and some of you are probably asking, whoa, why should I get involved in these kinds of activities? Why should I go through all that? Especially if it's going to be so negative. Well, this is a sermon, and we cannot leave here without hope. And maybe we can ask some questions in a different way and adjust our expectations. First, when we're working on a project, we often ask, how do we measure success? And in our lives, we have these pictures. It's very linear. You do the work. It's almost like a formula. I'm going to put this much in, and then I should get this much out. Well, I think we need to find a new way of thinking about success. And maybe success isn't even what we should be seeking. You know, we have so many analogies for winning. Reaching the finish line, meeting our goals, and making the deadline. But winning is not really what we're after. This winning suggests that someone else is losing. Is there some kind of superiority in needing to win? For now, perhaps our goal should be to just be on the path, working towards something. We know the way is rocky, and that we may stumble, but still, we need to be on the journey. And as Maya Angelou wrote, we may encounter many defeats, but we must not be defeated. Okay, the second thing, will I say or do something wrong? So many of us are concerned with being politically correct that we are paralyzed into inaction. Will you say or do something wrong at some point? Yes, absolutely. It's almost inevitable if you're really working towards solutions where there are differences and there are conflicts. But if you and your partners regard each other with respect and you've acted in a respectful way, I believe that you can get past those difficult moments because you've already been working on tearing down those walls. And the other thing is, nothing can be resolved in social justice if we don't do the work, if we don't take some risks, and if we are not somewhat vulnerable. The third thing, can't I just give money? Well, any movement needs money, and it is always welcome, but it's really the hands and hearts of people that bend the arc. It is not enough to intellectualize about oppression and suffering to feel their pain. And we've said it. I know I've said it. I feel your pain. But Amesh, a classmate of mine from India, says, you use outsource our social justice work by giving money so that we don't have to give time. And fourth and most importantly, what does Unitarian Universalism call us to do? Well, it calls us to act and to do the work that leads to justice. In 1853, Unitarian Church reformer Theodore Parker said, I do not pretend to understand the moral universe. The arc is a long one. My eye reaches but little ways. I cannot calculate the curve and complete the figure by the experience of sight. I can divine it by conscience, and from what I see, I am sure it bends toward justice. So the arc of the moral universe, can you visualize it? It could be shaped like a rainbow. It could be shaped like that symbol for bridges, that arc. So, here's where we are right now. Well, we're somewhere on the arc, and there's justice over there. Now, I don't think we can get there by sliding down the rainbow to try to get to the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. And Parker didn't say so, but the arc doesn't bend itself. We need to be part of the leverage that builds the bridges and bends the arc toward justice. To tear down walls and build bridges. To do what it takes to create a fair and compassionate world. Do the work with the people who are marginalized, not for them. Not for them, but for ourselves. And maybe we have walls within ourselves that need to be addressed. Go to Justice GA in Phoenix, Arizona this year, or the Parliament of World's Religions if you can afford it. Volunteer somewhere. And yes, continue to support causes financially. But we have to put in the blood, sweat, and tears. There are still walls to tear down, and maybe there always will be. Too few bridges have been forged to bring people together in spirit of love, hope, and compassion. If we fail to become personally involved in multi-faith and justice issues, we not only dishonor our Unitarian Universalist roots and principles, we become the architects of the unbuilt bridges.